Hachette Audio presents a Mel Brooks book, Young Frankenstein, the story of the making of the film. Written by Mel Brooks with Rebecca Keegan. With a foreword written and read by Judd Apatow. Read by Mel Brooks, Michael Gruskoff, Ellen Archer, and Robert Petkoff. Includes a Mac and PC compatible PDF of photos.
Foreword.
Mel Brooks is the funniest. That we all agree on. There is no need to debate it. All of us who try to make comedy know we will never be the best. Mel wins. What we can debate is which is the best Mel Brooks movie. Yes, this is a subjective question. If you choose Blazing Saddles or The Producers or High Anxiety, I can't prove you wrong. But allow me to make the case for Young Frankenstein. Young Frankenstein is perfect. It's the comedy equivalent of Sgt. Pepper or The Great Gatsby or the 86 New York Mets. The pace and joke compression are off the charts. The laughs are huge. The jokes land like the punches of a prize fighter in furious volleys from all different angles, the big ones landing when you least expect them. What modern comedy doesn't owe a debt of gratitude to Young Frankenstein? The physical comedy is both precise and insane. The genre parody is spot on and meticulously detailed. There have been a million spoof movies since, but none of them even comes close. You don't need to know a thing about Frankenstein to love this movie. Plus, Marty Feldman's looks to camera are so well-timed and iconic, he's basically inventing The Office in 1974. Gene Wilder, also the co-writer, is on fire throughout the movie. He's like a comedy cheat code. It's unfair. One second he's screaming at the top of his lungs, mania in his eyes, and the next second he's teasing extra laughs with just the tiniest look or smile or gesture. The casting is perfect. The women in Young Frankenstein are historically hysterical. What is funnier than Frau Blücher slowly turning to Dr. Frankenstein and asking him if he'd like some Ovaltine? Or Inga's role in the hay? Terry Garr, Cloris Leachman, Madeline Kahn. Mel directed these brilliant women in some of their finest performances. Okay, their finest performances, in my opinion. Even Gene Hackman is funny in it. When has Gene Hackman ever been that riotously funny? Sure, he was funny in Superman 3, or was it 4? But the spilled soup bit is as good as comedy gets. Every part of Young Frankenstein is perfect. When Gene Wilder is lecturing the class at the beginning of the movie, the science kind of makes sense. He sounds like he knows what he's talking about. And the movie is genuinely scary sometimes. The monster's speech at the end is emotional and touching. The sets and photography are gorgeous. Even without these things, it would still be one of the funniest movies of all time. But the fact that it succeeds in so many arenas is what makes it the absolute high watermark. Its credibility makes everything funnier and more impactful. Another thing to keep in mind, Mel Brooks made Young Frankenstein and Blazing Saddles in the same year. Has a director ever had a better year than Mel Brooks in 1974? Victor Fleming made Gone with the Wind and The Wizard of Oz in 1939, but Gone with the Wind isn't funny at all. Mel wins again. A few years ago, I went to see Young Frankenstein at a revival house, and it got the loudest, most sustained laughs I have ever heard in a theater. I was jealous, but then I realized I will never fight as well as Ali, I will never paint as beautifully as Picasso, and I will never be as funny as Mel Brooks. But even if you're only a third as funny as Mel, that still will make for a comfortable living. I am so glad that this book of beautiful photographs and information about this classic film is out. Maybe I will learn something. If I work hard, hopefully, I can get to 40%. Respectfully, Judd Apatow.
Introduction. You know, you have to really know a genre to make fun of it. And to really know it, you have to love it. When I was young, I loved the movies because they saved my life. I was so grateful to cinema for opening up worlds that were not open to me as a poor Jewish kid from Williamsburg in Brooklyn. I was born in 1926, and everybody in my building was headed for jobs in the garment district in Manhattan. Well, I assumed I'd be working in the shipping department somewhere on 7th Avenue. I never dreamed I would do something else, let alone make my living in movies. Nothing else was open to us then. But at the local movie theater, I could go anywhere. Arabia, the West, Transylvania. We played street games to keep busy in Williamsburg. Punch ball, baseball, roller hockey. But nothing nourished our dreams like the movies. Those movies gave us lovely worlds to inhabit. When I was a teenager and I saw Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers dancing on shiny, big, black and white floors, wow! You never saw shiny, big, black and white floors in Williamsburg. It was just oilcloth and sometimes Jewish newspapers covering them when your mother would wash them. We never had money for anything, but for one thin dime, you got 3 feature films, a race, some newsreels, some shorts. My mother would send me to the theater with a salmon and tomato sandwich wrapped in wax paper because it was a long, long day. I was 5 years old in 1931 when James Whale's Frankenstein came out. The following summer, the movie played at a theater in Williamsburg, and my older brother Bernie took me to see it. My father had died of tuberculosis when he was only 34 and I was 2. And then there was Mama, 30 years old, with 4 little boys. Mama had to clean. She wanted me out. Bernie said, I'm going to see Frankenstein. Maybe he will get scared. My mother said, I don't care. Take him. So Bernie took me, and that movie scared the hell out of me. I was really, seriously terrified. Big mistake. It was the scariest thing I ever saw in my life. Well, that was a pretty hot summer in Brooklyn, and in our 2-bedroom apartment, I slept right by the fire escape. I said to my mother, Ma, please close the window. She said, it's 100 degrees in here. I can't close the window. What's the matter? I said, if you leave the window open, Frankenstein will come and eat me. We called the monster Frankenstein because we didn't know the difference. He's going to eat me, my mother said. Okay, let's talk about this. First of all, the monster lives in Transylvania, Romania. Romania is not near the ocean, so he's going to have to get to Odessa or someplace to get a boat to America. He's going to have to go a long way to get that boat. Then he has to have money to pay for his passage. He may not have any money. Monsters don't carry money. He may not even have pockets. Well, let's say he gets money and he makes his way to Odessa and he gets a boat to America. The boat may go to Miami. It may go to Baltimore. It may not go to New York. All right, let's say it goes to New York and he gets off there. He doesn't know our subway system. If he finds the BMT, what we used to call the subway back then was the BMT, and he gets to Brooklyn, he doesn't even know our street. Let's say he does find our street. But remember, the people on the first floor of our building, they have their window open too. He's not going to climb up 5 flights. If he's hungry and he's going to eat somebody, he's going to eat who's ever on the first floor. You know, my mother made sense. So I said, okay, leave the window open. But that movie haunted me. Actually, it haunted me for years. I mean, it was the scariest thing. I was always worried. And then to add insult to injury, this guy, James Whale, kept making more and more Frankenstein movies. Well, more than 40 years later, when I was finally a little less scared, Whale's movies would inspire me and my friend and collaborator, Gene Wilder, to make Young Frankenstein. I first met Gene in 1963 when he was starring in a Broadway production of Mother Courage with Anne Bancroft, whom I was dating at the time and would later marry. Gene and I would go on to make 3 wonderful movies together. The Producers in 1967, Blazing Saddles in 1974, and Young Frankenstein, also in 1974, which I consider our biggest achievement. Gene was absolutely incredible as Dr. Frankenstein in that. He was amazing. In Mother Courage, Gene Wilder played a chaplain. He'd come off the stage and say to me, I was standing in the wings, and he'd say to me, why are they laughing at me? And I said, look in the mirror. Blame God. You're meant to be funny. You can be other things, but you're always going to be funny. Don't fight it. Just be sincere. And always be amazed at the fact that they're laughing at you. It'll be good for you. It'll be good for your career. Gene and I hung out. We were good pals. We used to go out to dinner a lot. And I would tell Gene all about what I was doing. I was writing a script called Springtime for Hitler. It wasn't called The Producers yet. I'd tell him about this character, Leo Bloom. He's silly. He's angelic. He's tragic. He's the most brilliant accountant who ever lived. But as a human being, he's lost. He doesn't know how to behave. He's never been kissed. He doesn't know anything about anything. Gene said, you know, I could play that character. But he never thought we'd ever get the money to make it. Gene was growing as an artist. One day he replaced Alan Arkin on Broadway in a Murray Shiskal play called Love, L-U-V. He was in his dressing room taking off his makeup between a matinee and an evening performance when Sidney Glaser, the producer of The Producers, and I walked in. I threw a script down on the makeup table and said, never get the money, huh? Never do it, huh? Okay. In 2 months, we're going to be at Mendy Brown's studio on 26th Street, and we're going to start shooting The Producers, and you are going to be Leo Bloom. Gene held his hands over his face and wept. And I said, look, I can't use you if you just keep crying. You got to act. Gene is the most natural actor who ever lived. And I said to him, listen, Gene, you're free to do anything you want in this movie. I love you. Well, that's how we started working together. And as much as I had wanted Gene for The Producers, I didn't want him to be the Waco kid in Blazing Saddles. I thought he might be too funny. I was shooting for the stars. I wanted the eloquence of a John Gielgud in a Western outfit, a leather-faced guy who was beaten down, a real alcoholic. I didn't want him to be funny. I wanted the black sheriff to be funny and a couple of other people to be funny, all the Johnsons to be funny, but I wanted the Waco kid to be serious. Man, was I wrong. But I didn't know it yet. I hadn't realized if you can find a funny actor who can be serious, then you've got heaven. You've got the best. And that was Gene Wilder, who never knew how funny he was, who always played everything so seriously. So, to begin with, I cast Gig Young as the Waco kid. Gig had been starring in movies going way back to the 40s. He was in a wonderful comedy called Under the Yum Yum Tree. And then he won an Academy Award for They Shoot Horses, Don't They? With Jane Fonda. He had a serious alcoholic problem. I loved it. He was a serious alcoholic, and the Waco kid was an alcoholic. His agent said, don't worry about it. Gig's over it. No problem. He's licked it. So we did the first day of shooting. It became clear that he wasn't wholly over it. He was hung upside down in the jail cell. And the sheriff comes over and says, are we awake? And he's supposed to say, I don't know, are we black? And he said, are we blah, blah? And green stuff spewed from his mouth. And I said to my assistant director, wait a minute, are we making The Exorcist? What's happening here? Anyway, I knew that Gig was not over his alcoholism, that he was suffering from a bad case of DTs. So I had a look for somebody else. That night, with my star in no shape to film, I called Gene to cry to him. He said, Mel, I know every line. I had sent Gene a script about 6 months earlier, and he had memorized everything immediately. He had an amazing ability to do that. Gene came out the next day, tried on a costume, picked out a horse. That was Saturday. On Sunday, we did one rehearsal, and on Monday morning at 9 o'clock, we were shooting, and he was the Waco kid.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.